for our last presenter, and certainly not the least, I'd like to introduce Greg Papadopoulos from NEA. Great.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, so who has gray enough hair or may lack hair to know what that photo is? Bring back any, yes, Charlie. yes, a VAX 11780, right? It's a mini computer, and that is actually representative of the point of my talk here, that I think networking is in the mini computer era. And what we're about to see is the sort of microprocessor software revolution. A whole bunch of the dreams that we keep thinking about here is going to happen. And we're participating in that right now. I look at it now from my new vantage of a venture investor and sort of the creative destruction thesis here. So if that sort of well-crafted, sort of vertically integrated system is about to get broken up into pieces, how do you make money? And what does that look like? And I should say, by the way, it's not a completely disparaging thing that to make the analogy to mini computers. Actually, mini computers were beautifully well-crafted things. I mean, VMS, as part of the VAX family, was a superb operating system. It's a matter of, you know, what are the new opportunities that happen as that gets challenged. So that's basically where we're going to end up. Let me frame this, with sort of a big picture. Probably the biggest picture is, you know, the historians looking back 100 years from now and putting the label on our era in time, like, is significant to civilization as I think the Industrial Revolution was. What will we call it? And I think it will be labeled the networking revolution. That's what we're doing. We're connecting stuff. And I think the most profound thing about the phases that we're going through in our era is that as we've had this sort of predictable exponential decline in the cost of connecting things, we're actually having a super exponential increase in the things that we connect. Value goes up. We're willing to invest more of our economy into that. And we're going through this phase now of, I think, having well-connected people, we know what that looks like, to now connecting things and the machine-to-machine, when Stuart was talking about that. You know, all of these have interesting opportunities and challenges that go with it. If you look at, I think, what's also sort of instantaneously fueling this, and one way to look at, you know, trying to wrap your arms around what does all this mean, we've had both these, I think, an increasing slope on the exponentials of sort of the consumer access and the endpoint bandwidth, with some very interesting things happening in the wireless side from my point of view. I think one of the, of course, the scary and most exciting thing here is that if you project now what's happening with wireless data demand, it way outstrips our supply from these mechanisms, so we're going to be creative. So if you take a step back from this, a very simple way to look at, you know, what is the gross networking pressures on the system, it's sort of a Kirchhoff's law thing, right? That goes in has got to equal the goes out as. And if you're on the right-hand side and you're looking at all these devices that are creating all this demand, essentially that demand gets served somewhere through these pipes, right? Mostly peer-to-peer doesn't, you know, appear yet to be a significant piece of that, so you can work from the left and make your way to the right. And that has led to, this equation sort of on the bottom here, if you will, a very simple level that, you know, go add up all the devices on the right-hand side, multiply it by the bandwidth they're consuming, and you better have sort of the supply side of that in balance. And that leads to, I think, what we're seeing now. I mean, this is a profound transformation, whether you put it under cloud computing or whatever you say, your favorite label. Basically, we're building big computers, right? I don't know if he's still here, but, you know, Google, the people who have built the biggest computers on the planet, right? That is a surprising change from a decade ago, that actually these big systems are important. And what's a big computer? Right? You have millions of nodes. It's actually an assumption about your ability to control them, right, that I have the software control over these things. Stuart, I'm glad I put Verizon on there as one of the owners and runners of big computers. But some examples. Actually, you know, a little more sophistication perhaps to the, yeah, they're big computers, but also there are distribution networks. I'm careful not to say CDNs here because I do believe it's not only a lot more sophisticated than that, but it's sort of, if you want to say the revolution in the revolution, the top stuff gets all the attention now. I think the really interesting control points and challenges in the network are actually down below. So kind of coming back to our pipeline, you know, if you look at the potential for, you know, what's the equipment that gets used at each of these segments, okay? So, you know, sort of thinking access, kind of this content distribution layer, metro, to the core network, to data centers, where is this opportunity, where the reinvention is going to take place? The answer is everywhere, right? By, again, all of these things have to stay in balance. What I'm going to do is just, you know, go into the data center side of it now, just in a little more detail, because that's, you know, it is where it's happening first. There's a natural alignment between those big computers and having that sort of sense of control over all the computing and storage. We should have that sense of control over the networking too. So it's a very natural sort of alighting of those concerns. A little formatting here, but sort of coining Gordon Bell's law that, you know, the sort of, speaking of the vax, about every 10 or 15 years, you do see in the computing side sort of this architectural reinvention. And as we say, you know, mainframes, minis, PCs, symmetric multiprocessors. And there's some technology that's been sort of at the key of enabling that. And I think the interesting thing that happened, you know, as you look at the scale numbers on here, what's happened in the last decade in cloud computing essentially has been this enabling of, I think, you know, system on chip integration, but fast IP. What have we done is we've taken networks, this networking stuff, the IP networking stuff in particular, we've grabbed it and said, you know what? That makes a pretty interesting backplane, or it means at least a serviceable backplane for us to go build these big distributed computers. So we've sort of upped the scale there by putting these networking things as our backplanes by several orders, decimal orders of magnitude. And I think what we're seeing now, if I put a label on this next one of exascale, that essentially getting networks onto chips and then optical interconnect pushing its way down, I think, to the rack level and into backplanes and into the modules, that's going to happen. We're going to look back 10 years from now and it will be all reinvented. I actually see sort of OpenFlow style thinking and software-driven defined network style thinking penetrating into the rack and actually into the machines themselves and act as an organizing layer, much as the way we see virtualization as being important at that layer now. And then you'll see, you know, another couple of decimal orders of magnitude of sort of the biggest things we wrap our arms around and call computers. Okay, so back to that view of the networking. What is the difference between, you know, a pile of 10,000 servers and a big computer? Just to remind us all, it is the network, stupid. Right? That's what it is. That's the fabric. That's the thing that, you know, in some sense differentiates and lets us call it that. Okay, so from a, you know, value kind of control point, there are three people who vie for owning that, right? Coming from three points of view. You can come from the storage point of view, right? And what's cool about sort of pivoting all this stuff, hey, you know, storage is at the center, everything else is a peripheral, right? Now, computing's free, cycles are free, you know, networking is ubiquitous, we put it together, you know, bits have inertia, that mass, excuse me, so that, you know, an inertia, assuming the Higgs boson gets found, we'll know why. But, you know, that's the sticky part of the equation. Software, you know, I like software a lot because it has lots of delicious layers of value, right? And you can keep, stacking that up, and I'm going to say a little bit more about that in a minute. And And of course, networks being this backplane, well, hey, you know, they intermediate all these transactions. So shouldn't sort of network be the centerpiece of when you're thinking of designing these big systems and therefore value? Now, I'll give you a very strong bias, and this is from my background. Even though I'm the machine architect by training, sort of the, you know, what I observe in terms of big ecosystems being important is really about the creative act of building ecosystems that involve people writing software. And yes, the App Store. sorry, Dan, we have to do the App Store now. But it is for me, if you look at sort of historically in the greater sort of computing business, it's people who have successfully been able to build ecosystems that attract other people into them are the ones that get to go build these really long, enduring, and very profitable businesses. And I would come back to, again, in a message that sort of has become just stronger for me over the past 6 months from the last summit is, to me, this level of thinking about sort of, you know, the software and the software-defined networking to me is just a really critical thing. And I think that's going to lead into the next session in any case. So where does this go? All right, I said, let's use the mini computer sort of analogy there. I think clearly networking equipment has moved at a technological rate that is at least as fast as computing equipment and storage equipment, right? We're all building out of the same, you know, silicon and steel, right? And the same optical technologies and all that. So this is not about the technology level, it's about the organizing principles, right? The organizing principles of networking equipment has basically not changed in a couple of decades, partly because networking is that conservative. I mean, that's part of it too. So there are these monolithic, very well-crafted systems. If you recognize the equipment and you're from one of those companies on the left-hand side, I'm not saying you're digital, okay? This is the pictures I took off the web. that's kind of where we are. So if you were to imagine what happens, we think it's like this, right? There is basically a process now of decomposition and specialization. You're tearing it apart, and people are going off and becoming sort of crafty at these different layers and specializing in those layers. And you know, from an investment point of view, there are places to invest at all levels, and I'll talk about that. I saw James Lau earlier today. I think that is a Pika 8 switch in there, just coincidentally. If you look at places where we've invested, down at the monolithic Fulcrum was an investment we had made early on now at Intel. Certainly the areas going up the stack, Nicira, M-Brain is another company sort of up a little higher, I think it would put in the applications layer. But as we start peeling this back, and I think it's partly a bit of vocabulary. I saw it, Stuart. I was really interested in seeing this sort of, orchestration layer, orchestration versus control plane thing. I tend to use the labels of control and management, all right? And then are you really talking about sort of orchestrating sort of up to layer three kinds of things, or you're looking at application behavior? But I think this stuff will sort out. But you can ask then, what goes on next? So the next, we get to this. What you see in the computing business, right, is a reintegration, because this is the phase that it goes through, is wrapping your arms around it, actually being able to put these now newly competed for and refined technologies together into larger systems. You see a lot of this stuff. Cisco Unified Computing, the Exadata systems. I saw IBM do this all in the enterprise space. Clearly, large-scale service providers are doing this on their own, and there are lots of companies putting that together. So there will be some reintegration. I think there will be some re-verticalization of the companies, and it may be some of those left-hand companies go through this transition and actually emerge on the right-hand side of having done that. And I think that's a very credible path. And I'll just leave you with what we've been operating off for a while is another way that we look at this investment map is just looking at the data control and management planes. Sort of what are you down at what layers in the stack are you, and then which part of this slices of the pipeline from access network to data centers are you in, and I think this is it's all greenfield. Okay, thank you very much.